most beautiful place in the world, where a Tar Heel blue sky blankets Murphy on its way to the Tennessee border. It's a long way from Raleigh and the Outer Banks, but we're living in Carolina too. In fact, you might call it extreme Carolina. With more, here's Michael Borkman.
Hello, hello, good morning, everyone. This is Extreme Carolina. My name is Michael Borkman. I'm your host for the show. And today, hold on to your hats. We have an amazing, amazing show lined up. But I want you all that are listening, this show is recorded, but it's so good. So I have to say it and preface it with the fact that we're talking about Veterans Day. So hats off, tips to all the veterans here that has gave what they've given to our country. Thank you so much. So now we want to talk to and invite into our studio a very, very good guest, a friend of mine, Candace Harden Littlejohn. She's the editor of a magazine called Bohemian Renaissance. And she is an amazing editor. And let's just get right to it. And welcome to the show, Candace.
Thank you for having me.
Well, it is our pleasure. Thank you so very much to have you on Extreme Carolina. We're so excited about it. And let's just dive right into it. What we like to do, though, we like to, every time we have a guest, especially sitting in the chair, and you are in the chair, and we want to ask a question about how did you get where you are? But before we get to that exactly, success is built on failures.
Absolutely.
A ton of failures. But we would like to ask if you could give us one of those failures that has happened in your life that was that really turned the tide or really got you going in the right direction, a failure that happened that you can share with us.
Certainly.
So if you would, please.
I've been in restaurant work since 1999 as far as behind the scenes. And so in the 2000s, I decided to open a couple of restaurants, which I did.
Wow.
One did very well, and one I opened right as the recession bloomed on top of us. And
2008.
Okay. And it did okay for a while, but I put a lot of money into it trying to make it work. And unfortunately, it was a time where nothing would have worked because there was no money. And most of my clients were real estate people and loan brokers. So they were just, we were all hurting. And I beat myself up about the failure for a long time because I had a couple of partners and I felt like, well, maybe I let them down. I let myself down. I should have done, what could I have done? What could I have made better? And eventually I came to the realization to forgive myself about it and realize it was never my destiny to do that, that I had a different destiny.
Oh.
So I reached back in time. And before my daughter was born in 1997, I had wanted to publish a literary magazine.
Okay.
And I had put all that on hold for motherhood and career and all that. And I thought, you know what? If I'm going to be out of work and, having issues, I might as well do something that I have always wanted to do. So
passionate about.
I'm very passionate about writing. And this is a venue for people to get published.
Okay.
It's a nonprofit, so I accept donations and I give the magazines away free. Because a lot of the art industry, like movies and books and all that, it's all based on the dollar. Am I going to make $1 million? Am I going to make money? Well, people who have very, very good skills get overlooked because maybe it won't make $1 million. And they're still good. The art still needs to be out there. The written word needs to be out there. We don't need three RoboCops,
I know
screenwriters that could give you wonderful stuff, and, of course, they're not being, being pursued. So it's very important that people get art, and I try to find a very good artist every time. And literature, people that write stories, poems, whatever they have, I think it's all good. And I'll work with you. You know, if you have issues or you're not such an experienced writer, I'll work with you until, it reads smoothly.
Nice.
And artists are more, they're kind of on their own because I'm an okay artist, but not great. So I'll concede to their good offices on that.
Well, that is great. So your failure turned around and became your passion. Success in this man, because I consider you a success, because I'm actually holding a copy of it right here in my hand, and it looks great, and it's got a lot of great stuff in it. And see, and that's what a lot of people don't realize. A lot of us go to work day in, day out for 30, 40, 50 years doing a job, that we're not passionate about.
Right.
And then a lot of times we're just going along just like cattle, just following along. One day we wake up, boom, we're out of a job and don't know what to do. So if we can find something that's in our passion, man, that'll be great for one thing, because you'll be alive. And number two, if you're really good at something, somebody will probably end up paying you for it, you know, because you're really good at it. So anyway, and yours is coming. Hold on.
That's the goal. But, you know, until then, I get paid with the satisfaction of
there you go, because there's more than one way to get paid. And you have just enlightened us. Okay, well, great. We're going to move it along. For those that are just joining us, this is Extreme Carolina. You stopped on the dial at 95.1. Thank you so much for stopping. Today, we're here with Miss Candace Harden Littlejohn. And she's an amazing, amazing editor, mom, wife, and sister, friend. I mean, she does a lot of stuff, got a lot of hats. And she's also a human resource officer at her job, which is a job, you know, but we won't get into that. Because today we want to talk about this magazine that she's putting out. It's called Bohemian Renaissance. Now, well, the question I have, so you touched on it about a passion you had years ago. This is how this magazine came to be. Is it something you've always wanted to do? How did you just?
It's something I've always wanted to do. Anytime you write, you get a ton of rejection letters, and that's
deflating.
That's deflating. Yes, you're like, oh man, and
it's nice
to give people a yes. I'd love to put your piece in my magazine. It's encouraging to people. You know, mm-hmm. I wasn't the greatest writer 20 years ago.
Right.
I do a lot more. I write for The Clash Daily, for mm-hmm. Politi Chicks, as a journalistic articles, but I also write, I have a poetry book, and I write short stories and things like that. And your expression is always valid. Everybody's expression is always valid.
Mm.
Like I say, when you take the money out of the equation, you can enjoy the art of it.
Oh. Art of it. I like that.
Yes.
The art of it. Awesome. Well, in this magazine that you have put out, and it is a nonprofit venture that you're doing, and there's a lot of people that can be sponsors if they wanted to. We'll put this on the show notes, so if anyone wanted to contact you, wanted to know how to find out about how they can be a part of it, one way to do that is how. Tell us, we get that in real quick.
You can go in bohemianrenaissance.com, and
okay.
It gives you all the information on how to donate or how to get in touch with me if you have a submission. Also, I have a GoFundMe page right now under
okay.
Bohemian Renaissance.
Nice.
So either one of those would work.
Okay. And we'll also, folks, put that on the show notes page, so you can go to Extreme Carolina Facebook page and check it out, and we'll have all that information that she said, which she will say again at the end of the show. So let's just get right back to it before we come up on a break. Now, in this Veterans magazine, which is so, so cool that I had to make sure that I let everyone know this is a recording, but it's so important about the Veterans Day. So before we take a break, can you give us a real short clip about the why Veterans Day is so important?
Well, yesterday's Veterans Day was the 100th anniversary of the, quote, war to end all wars, World War I. It was the 11th day, the 11th hour in 1918. Of course, it did not end all wars, and the Treaty of Versailles ended up pretty much starting the Second World War,
right.
Or the violation thereof of the Treaty of Versailles. So it's very important to remember that there have been so many people who have given everything to our country, up in, and including their life,
mm-hmm.
and the ones who have come back suffer horribly from PTSD, which I touched on in a couple of things
yeah.
in there, and you don't understand how they wake up screaming in the middle of the night,
mm.
how a simple something can trigger horrible memories, and you just have to be patient, you have to be kind, and you have to understand that you have to give this person some space, let them get that
yeah.
out of their system a little
right.
bit. Don't argue, don't mm-hmm. confront, don't try to, you know, change behavior. Just say, okay, and then just give them space.
Right.
Because they are traumatized, and
right.
they can't get it out of their head, and your freedom is their nightmare for the rest of their lives.
Mm. Wow, that is so powerful statement right there. We're going to probably pick back up on that when we come back from the break. But we want to take a break here in just a minute here, or less than a minute, and give our sponsors an opportunity to jump in, do what they do, and then we'll come back on the other side. And I want to pick back up on that PTS thing, that statement you made about their nightmare is our freedom.
Exactly.
It's amazing. They paid the price for us to be free. I got some questions about that. But anyway, we'll take a break right here. Don't go anywhere, anyone. We'll be right back with Extreme Carolina and Candace Harton, Little John.
Tar Heel basketball, Cam's Panthers, Asheville's eclectic nightlife, and the Great Smoky Mountains. It belongs to us, too, out here in Extreme Carolina. Once again, here's Michael Borkman.
Welcome back, everyone. Welcome back. Here we go once again with Candace Littlejohn here. We got her in here. She's an editor, writes an amazing magazine, and this is not the first one. It's many of them, but I think this is the first one that is dedicated to Salute of the Veterans Edition, correct?
Exactly, to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the Armistice.
Ah, okay. And it's called Bohemian Renaissance. If you guys want to go find it or go online and pull it up, and you'll be able to find it or give her a call, check her on Facebook. She'll be happy to get you one. So anyway, now, as we ended the first half of the show, we were talking about PTSD and the WW2 veteran. And if you would, please just touch on that a little bit. Now, we won't cover the whole thing, but for those of you all that are interested, she's got an article on it. It's in her magazine. So go find the magazine and you can get the rest of the story. But anyway, tell us a little bit about that PTSD thing that happens, and it's a traumatized thing. You don't have to be been in the war. I mean, it can happen in a car accident or anything like that.
Right.
But in this case, we're talking about veterans who daily, for probably a year or two or whatever, seen this devastation and stuff, and really made them just freaked out with seeing that stuff. You'd be in an accident one time, maybe in your lifetime.
Hopefully, yeah.
You know, maybe. But these guys seen it day in, day out. So tell us just a little bit about that and what you've written in the magazine.
Well, as I said, PTSD on a veteran, every day is a nightmare to them. And your peaceful sleep, they are having nightmares. I think that the World War II veterans, they called it battle fatigue at that time. Mm-hmm. And it was not as bad on them, although I'm sure they did have bad memories. But they came home to a grateful nation. They came home to a family unit in the social structure. They were not spit on or have things thrown at them or protested like the Vietnam vets were. And people ostracized the Vietnam vets because they disagreed with the war. Well, a man in the service, excuse me, sir, I don't agree. Yeah, too bad. Sit down, shut up, you know.
That's right. Get your gun and get out there.
Yeah, it doesn't work that way. Right. And so I think that the World War II vets had less, because they had more familiar support, they had more societal support.
Oh, makes sense.
The Vietnam vets were treated very poorly.
Almost with no help.
And then, what they would do is they give them psychotic drugs or give them electric shock treatments to try and get rid of it.
Terrible.
And what that did was erase good memories and leave the bad ones. So it's a very big subject, and it needs to. If you have any questions about it, you need to go online, look it up, read about it, learn how to deal with it, or you can read some in my book, my articles.
Yep.
But it's a very real, debilitating daily problem for them.
Okay. Well, again, folks, she wrote an article on this in her magazine, and the magazine, once again, is called Bohemian Renaissance. And the article is PTSD and the WW2 veteran. So go get the magazine, check it out. You'll love it. It's a great magazine. I love this magazine. Speaking of the magazine, now you did a lot of stuff on veterans, different types of veterans. You did a whole thing on your husband, his family, your family.
Yes.
And a lot of how the war started and what did it, or what even started the war. All that is in this magazine.
Yes.
And so you're dedicating this entire magazine to veterans.
Absolutely.
Which is what I admire. I respect that. I think that is so cool because our veterans don't get the respect that they deserve.
No, there's no way you could repay debt. There's no way you could send an 18-year-old into a combat situation and you be able to make that up to them. You can't.
Wow. So. Yeah, and us just saying thank you for your service, it is something, but it is nowhere near what they given.
That's right.
They gave, well, in a lot of cases, their life.
They're all, yes.
Yeah, and don't come back. And the statement you made just before we went to break, well, it was so touching. I saw that somewhere in the magazine where you said that their nightmares was they got nightmares so that we could have a peaceful sleep.
Exactly. Yes. Nobody, unless you've got someone close to you that has that, can understand the depth of it and how you and me are not going to experience that, hopefully, in our life.
Right.
And it's very difficult to explain to someone. A lot of people say, well, just get over it. Well, you really can't.
You can't. Yeah, you're right. You and I will never experience it. Well, one of the reasons is because we won't be 18 again, being drafted in a war.
That's the sorry part, not being 18, but I need to know what I know now at 18.
Oh, my goodness. You'd be dangerous.
Yes, I would be. I'd be taking over the world.
But anyway, for those who just joined us here at Extreme Carolina, we are so blessed today to have with us Candace Littlejohn, the editor of Bohemian Renaissance. And we're talking about her latest magazine. And she puts this magazine out monthly.
Quarterly.
Quarterly, yeah. Okay. But there's not a quarter left in the year, but yet you're going to come out with another one at the end of the year.
Yeah, sometimes because I do have to work a job in order to keep lights and on and rent paid and all.
Day job.
I have to, try to put out my magazines, and sometimes they'll back up to each other like they do this time. But I want to get one more out before the end of the year.
Okay. So all of us should be looking forward to that because it's going to be a feature in there that's talking about a very good friend of yours that you, when you guys were in kindergarten or whatever, early school.
Elementary school.
Elementary school. And she went on to be a veteran in the war, and you're going to be talking about her in the next magazine.
Right. She's the artist of featured artist in the next magazine. She wasn't in combat, but she was a U.S. Marine.
Mm-hmm.
And she went on to be, she was always very artistic as a child, but she went on to be a very, very, very good sculptor, photographer, and different things that she does.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to bring that forward to kind of kiss this one because they're back to back.
Right.
So it's a vet that I'm featuring as an artist in the next issue.
Okay. And the next issue will be out.
Hopefully by the end of December.
All right. End of December. We will be keeping an eye out for that. We will definitely make sure that, and we'll talk about that here on. As a matter of fact, you let us know when it comes out, and we'll tell everybody about it.
Sounds great.
And that way that everybody can be aware of the Bohemian Renaissance.
Exactly.
How'd you come up with that name?
Oh, it's my dad was one of those straight-laced kind of people from the 50s and 60s. And so when I would be acting wild and really enjoying myself, he would tell me, stop acting like a bohemian. So that's where that came from. I said, okay. I'm going to bring that back as in Renaissance to redo that. But when I was really enjoying myself and yelling, screaming, running all around, he would tell me to stop acting like a bohemian. So that's where that came from.
Okay, that's a good enough. And speaking of when you were having a good time and doing things, now, we also like to ask our guests. Usually our guests are doing things in the community, doing something that's like leadership. And leaders generally tend to be readers. And so we like to push reading. Reading is you just cannot do enough of that self-education, and that is through reading. So if you would please share with our listeners, what book have you read recently that had the biggest impact on you and why?
Well, I'm reading Killing Patton by Bill O'Reilly and his ghostwriter.
Really?
And it's very, first of all, I always was a fan of Patton because I'm not a sugarcoater. I won't tell you what I think, but if you ask me, you better step back.
Good, here it goes.
Because I'm not going to tell you, okay, that's fine, or whatever. I'm going to tell you what I think, if you ask. And, he didn't ever wait to really be asked, but he was very blunt. He was a very good general, and some of the things, the philosophies he labored under, I enjoyed. And
right.
in this book, it talks about him writing some prayers to God, and he's talking to him like he's briefing a major or something, you know, or a commander over him.
Okay.
And I found that very entertaining. And right. It's very interesting, and it has a lot of great historical fact in it. They did a lot of great research.
And the name of it one more time.
Killing Patton by Bill O'Reilly.
Awesome. Okay. Well, it looks like we're getting ready to come up on the end of the show. Wow. Was that fast?
That was fast.
Unbelievable. Now, but for those that are wondering on that last statement you made when you said Patton, that's General George S. Patton.
Absolutely. Okay. General George S. Patton.
Junior.
Yes.
Okay.
I don't think anybody would call him Junior, though.
Really good. Well, you know, again, we came up on the end of it. Wow, it went so fast. I mean, you know, maybe we'll get a chance to do it again in 2019.
Love that.
But we are definitely at the end of our show, so we got to just say say bye to everybody. But you know what? We always have a quote of the day at the end of the show, and I'm going to dip into the Bohemian Renaissance and get a quote. And say it for our listeners. And here we go. Quote of the week is this. A man must know his destiny. If he does not recognize it, he is lost. By this, I mean once, twice, at the very most, three times. Fate will reach out and tap a man on his shoulder. If he has imagination, he will turn around and fate will point out to him what fork in the road he should take. If he has the guts, he will take it.
Absolutely.
All right.
That's General George S. Patton.
Thank you so much. And we're about to shut it down. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Candace.
Thank you.
Take care. Peace. We see y'all. Carolina, staring up the road and pray to God I see headlights.